The community design presentation is a really exciting milestone to reach in a project journey. For me, it represents a really key milestone. And for this particular project, it's a culmination of literally years of planning and thousands and thousands of hours of consultation, collaboration and design evolution. I just want to invite our Vice-Chancellor, Professor David Lloyd, to open the session and share with us some of UniSA's vision.
I'm really pleased to be here this morning because this is a really important day for us. And as Christine said, it's been a journey, and it's been an interesting journey. If I go back to when I was appointed, which is back in August of 2012, we were talking about the creation of not one building, but two separate buildings. One was going to be about the health clinics, and the other one was going to be for the CCB. And neither of them were in the biomedical precinct. They were both down this end of town, but they were on this side of the road. There was no vision for an integrated facility. There was no presence of UniSA in the future of health research in South Australia. And what changed from the end of August in 2012 to now was that we brought everybody together. And collectively, we figured out a way that we could actually build something which was going to be spectacular. And it will be spectacular. You'll see today the design, which provides a gateway to the precinct, which actually bridges between the old city and the new city in terms of Adelaide itself, and goes all the way back to what we really wanted to deliver as an institution, which is something that doesn't turn its back on the public, something which invites people in and which celebrates innovation and creativity. The components of the building, from the public science space site on the ground floor, through the health innovation clinics, through to the CCB, are all spectacularly well designed, very, very functional, but really they speak about this institution. They're vibrant, dynamic, inviting spaces. And the engagement piece, when you think about it, will have practitioners, researchers, students, and the public, and industry. Hewlett-Packard are going to be in this building. It's a vision which has coalesced over years. The team have had to pull up with flights of fancy from nobody in particular, but they put up with them pretty well. And it's progressed exceptionally smoothly. We've had numerous conversations about how tall the building is going to be. We eventually settled on a building that looks taller than it actually is. And what you'll see in the course of the morning is how these components interplay and how these pieces are actually going to support us into the future in what we put on the team, in health innovation. It's not a research building. It's not a practitioner's building. It's both. It's bringing the two together. And that translational component between those elements in the building, I think, will impact on the way in which we deliver innovation in health. It's a hugely exciting project. Universities are really lucky. They get to engage in public infrastructure and see these things realised over the lifespan of the people who are in this room. We're going to have a lasting impact on the landscape in South Australia, but also on the landscape of UniSA. So it's a great project, hugely exciting, and I hope you all enjoy what you see today and interrogate people, ask questions as well. So you're very welcome, and I hope you enjoy the session.
So the building will have 14 levels. There's a lower ground, a mezzanine, and then 12 core levels, and it's about 29,000 square metres in gross floor area. Within the building itself, there is the very exciting and innovative site gallery, so the Science Creativity Education Studio. We have spaces on another level where Hewlett-Packard are coming to play with the university, really, in lots of ways, and create a very exciting innovation collaboration hub, which is going to be very intensely focused around ICT capability. Two levels of allied health clinics. There are a couple of growth floors. So we've planned for three growth floors within the building. And then at the top end of the building itself is the Centre for Cancer Biology. The project also incorporates an urban park. We have, as part of our parcel of land, and you can just get a sense of, I'm not sure if this is going to point to it, but the skate park site is basically our boundary and takes us through from the railway yards in the back, North Terrace at the south, Moffat Street Bridge to the east. But we have, the government has planned for a future underground rail easement, so We have an urban park that's been created at the junction between our site and the University of Adelaide site, and we are designing that urban park in collaboration with the University of Adelaide. So it brings, the site is quite an interesting and complex place in itself, but the urban park and trying to bring together two design teams, two universities with their various philosophies and design drivers, quite an interesting and challenging piece of space to evolve.
Okay, good morning. Well, as Christina said, this was the very room that the architects and the consultant team actually started this project when we had not only our project briefing, but then our project startup. So on behalf of the architectural and engineering teams, it's really quite an honour to be back here presenting to you where we've got to with the project to date. So what we're going to take you through this morning is not just what the building is, but why the building is like it is, because there are so many, as Christina said, various planning constraints, briefing requirements, contextual requirements that have gone into this building, which make it, which actually make it what it is. So as you're no doubt all aware, it sits almost directly opposite us on North Terrace and on the corner of the Morford Street Bridge. There were a series of planning requirements. So for this overall site, a planning document was developed called the Common Development Framework, and that was before our time, and it was a document that we then inherited and had to review and take on the guidelines of. And the University of South Australia were a contributor to this document, which is effectively a master plan. It went through a number of different requirements on the site. One is considering a future underground rail easement on the site, which determines actually the footprint of the building. So when you look at the footprint of our building, it's actually quite unusual. It's because of this diagonal rail easement that runs all the way through the site for looking to provision of sort of infrastructure for Adelaide in the future. It also considers the buildings on the overall site, and there's a number of them. SAMRI is obviously the very first of them. And there's a discussion of SAMRI 2, the University of South Adelaide's building next door, and then ours here, as a series of what they call pavilions in the park. So buildings that are seen very much in the round as opposed to elements that are sort of standing with buildings either side of them. It also plotted pedestrian networks and paths, so how people should and could move around the facilities, and then looked also at being able to keep all of the services access and vehicular access off North Terrace and onto the front of the railway, so that the front to North Terrace is very much a pedestrian focus. And it began to determine the heights, both from an urban perspective as well as from an aircraft perspective. So something was set called the OLS, which is the obstacle limitation surface. And that's a sort of a line across all the buildings in the city which is determined for aircrafts above. So as Christina said, we started absolutely with the program of the building, all the various elements that are in it. And this is really a summary of them. There's the science and education galleries, which is a really wonderful and exciting contribution to sort of the public realm of the building on the street levels. There's the allied health clinics, both teaching and public clinics. There's an area allocated in the building for growth, for future opportunities and partnerships. And then there's one of the major tenants in the building, which is the Centre for Cancer Biology, a major research group. So for us, it was aspirationally, how can we take a series of sort of potentially quite disparate elements all sitting within that building and starting to think about how they could begin to work together, taking scientists sort of out of their laboratories, looking at how they can communicate and interrelate both with other people in the building and with the wider environment, looking at how people can move vertically, how they can connect the opportunity for views and the opportunity for bringing light and fresh air into the building itself. And ultimately, it's about trying to create an overall approach to a building that's really about developing a community, and that's a community, as David said, of ideas and innovation. So if we start to look at what our constraints from a planning perspective are, we've got this, as I said, quite unusual footprint, which is determined by the rail easement, which runs diagonally through here, and that's the footprint at a ground level. We're able to push a little bit beyond that and cantilever over that that footprint, which our structural engineers are doing all sorts of structural gymnastics to enable us to support being able to maximise the overall building envelope. So we can then get a larger footprint on those upper levels. We've got the urban park on the ground level, which is the ground plane of the rail easement, which is sitting below it, which then makes perfect sense to be able to draw the building entry straight in from that urban park. And then that gives us a lovely opportunity to connect straight across North Terrace and back into the remainder and the rest of the campus itself. We also have the ability, because we've pushed up to the Morfitt Street Bridge in terms of the boundary, to actually access the building at the Morfitt Street Bridge level at different points within the building, and then use the northern side of the building, which is where the rail is, for drop-off and vehicular access, so that that's not on the street itself. So there's an opportunity for fantastic views to the north, really lovely views to the south as well, and then a very nice aspect down North Terrace to the east. And because we've got such a large north and south frontage, it enables us to sort of minimise what are often very hard facades to be able to manage from a solar perspective, which is the east and the west, and that's where the sun is as low as possible, and it's very hard to protect a building from the sun. So we have our building footprint, and one of the major requirements, as I said, is the Centre for Cancer Biology as a research tenant and a research space. So we need to think about how to plan this building from a research perspective, and what does that then lend us to do and have us begin thinking about in terms of the planning opportunities. Often laboratory and research buildings sort of comprise a whole series of elements. One is lab support spaces, and they're traditionally a whole series of sort of small rooms full of equipment. One is the open lab areas, which is an environment like that, and then of course the workspace and the write-up areas for the researchers. And they're often run in linear elements. Now, in looking at how we can combine that sort of an approach in this building, obviously we don't want to be putting all of those small rooms up against all these lovely northern and southern opportunities for view and aspect. So we came up with an approach that sort of shifted the traditional planning model for research buildings, and we treated the lab support spaces as an island right in the centre of the building because we've got a nice deep footprint. We then wrap those open laboratory areas around that and then position the workspace and the write-up areas alongside it, so there's excellent visibility between workspace and write-up. And what that means is both from the workspace and all laboratories, we're maximising those views to the north and to the south, as well as, of course, views back into the building itself, rather than sort of shutting one down from a services perspective. And then we've looked at positioning a major element, a vertically connected space within the building itself, so that rather than every single level being isolated, we look at trying to connect them. We've positioned a major lift core, the public core, so the public lifts for people coming in and out every day at one end. And then we've positioned a service lift core up at the other end for goods and dangerous goods deliveries, waste and the like. And then this is an indication of the way we've looked at the connection of this of vertical space and atrium within the building. But of course, it's something that if, as Christina said, you know, the building is over 14 levels. If you look at a space that's 14 stories high, it can become quite overwhelming, and something rather than being a space you want to engage with, it actually becomes terrifying, it's so tall. So we've looked at how we can sort of split it over different elements and sides of the building. So it goes from the north and then flips over to the south. So as you look at the overall height of the building, that is a space actually goes from the north to the south, back to the north, and then connects into the entry. So it's this sequence of interconnected spaces. So if we just look at how all of those elements work within the building itself, we've got these major atria which connect the levels. We've got the science galleries on those lower levels near the entry, again connecting into one of those atria. We've got the allied health clinics that bridge atria on the north and the south and look back down into the science galleries. We've got growth floors and then the Centre for Cancer Biology up on those top levels with the connection to the north. So really it's about a network of these three major spaces within the building that we then ultimately wrap a building envelope around. And one of those elements has a real presence to the street on North Terrace, and the other two atria have a real presence to the north side, across the bridge and across the Torrens. So a typical plan without any workspace sort of fit out on it looks like this. We've got a lift core, public lift core here, and the services lift core there. So, for example, a typical plan on the cancer research, we have all of those support laboratories, the open plan labs to the north and to the south, workspace here, and then this lovely interconnected space here, which is sort of full of a whole series of areas, meeting spaces and informal collaboration spaces that can be used also. And then the health clinics teaching spaces. So again, large training, conference facilities, gymnasia, consult rooms, and then this lovely atria on the north side. So this just gives an indication of how some of those areas are connected. So this is the science galleries down at this level, and then you can see as it winds up via stairs and platforms for waiting areas, etc., in the health allied health clinics, that people are able to see and be a part of other elements of the building. The student common room in the health floor is connected through to one on the north and views out to the south. And then there's the CCB atrium, and they are quite complex and quite rich spaces, and we've done that intentionally so that they're not sort of singular. And as a result, we built many, many study models to make sure that we get those spaces right. So this shows the four floors of the CCB atrium, a beautiful tea room and a terrace on the ground level with a large seminar room that opens out to that. And then this network of stairs, meeting rooms, collaboration rooms that wind all the way up to the building, to their major boardroom, with the laboratories looking straight into that. So these atria include open garden terraces, which is a really important component of the building, that you can be high up in a building like this and still be able to sort of breathe fresh air, sit outside and enjoy the sun. And then this is the seminar and tea room, with seminar opening straight onto a tea room, which then has access to this lovely terrace on level 8. And then you can see the various levels as the stairs wind up. Everyone is able to be connected into these spaces. So then let's look at the ground plan and how we actually get into the building and what some of those constraints are. Whilst North Terrace looks amazingly flat, it's not. So we start lower and end up higher at the building itself. The University of Adelaide sit right here, and they've started to determine a number of levels via their building as well, because they're higher up the hill. So that started to look at a series of sort of levels and setting levels for us. What we've been able to do is create a lower ground floor, which is at the same level as the railway, which is essentially where the skate park is at the moment. And that means on that northern side, we can bring vehicles in without having an impact on North Terrace. We then come up a series of stairs or a small ramp from the ground level at North Terrace straight into the building's entry. And then we've created a mezzanine floor that's suspended over the northern access road down here. And that level is actually exactly the same height as the Morford Street Bridge. So that enables the ability to come in from the Morford Street Bridge level. So in terms of how you get to the building, there's drop-off for the health clinics that come around and along that northern access road. You either come in for services or patient drop-off and then continue on. It's a one-way road. Or on the upper level, there's no vehicles. It's all pedestrian access from the bus stop and the tram stop in the middle of the road, straight through and into the main entry of the building, or across from the rest of the university, across the road via the pedestrian crossing through here. So ramping up stairs and into the main entry with the urban park as the setting for the entry itself. Also, the ability to come down the rest of Morford Street and through sort of further from the east. And in doing so, we have a street gallery as a part of SciCEd, and that sits down at a lower level so that the building is never too high up to be able to engage with the users in the street, even though the main entry is slightly higher here. So that's how we're utilising the levels and not sort of having a 2 metre wall to the street. And this street gallery runs all along the length of the building before it starts to curve, with a whole series of fantastic changing exhibitions that will be wonderful to sort of see and look into. Now, I mentioned the Morford Street Bridge access. So we've created what we call the sort of the grand stair that comes down from the west. So anyone approaching from Morford Street Bridge is able to come down this stair and through and into the building, or potentially up onto the mezzanine levels as well. So Morford Street Bridge, you come through and down a stair, and that stair then comes through and links straight onto North Terrace, with the building bridging over the top of the stair itself. So because of all of these various levels, it's enabled us to create a whole series of really interesting volumes in the gallery spaces, which is working incredibly well for the nature of some of the exhibits. So the entry, cafe, bookshop and shop, a large lecture theatre, and then moving into the galleries themselves. So the entry volume, you can see the bridge that's coming in from the mezzanine level up to the next level, which is where the Hewlett-Packard incubator spaces are, spaces that look back down into there from into the lobby from the some of the laboratory, some of the maker spaces, and then this lecture theatre we have here, and then moving into the street galleries. That lecture theatre is a combined lecture theatre and gallery space, so retractable seating moves back, and it is able to form an exhibit, which you can see here. Up at the mezzanine, there's a large terrace as well as a series of gallery spaces. And that terrace is linked in with the health clinic's terrace as well. So those areas are looking across and down at one another. So exhibits in the science galleries are able to be enjoyed by people who are up waiting for a consultation in the health clinics themselves. And then the street gallery from the inside, opportunity for changing exhibits, coming through and down a corridor and into the beautiful Planet Gallery, which is going to be an amazing feature of the building itself. So then what does this building look like? As architects, we spend a lot of time sketching, having all sorts of ideas about what we might do. And we go through a process like this. We also build endless models to look at the form, the height, how we can sort of shape and create a building that really does fit into its context. But of course, we need to think absolutely about this context, and this is a building that's sitting very much in the heart of the city and in quite a unique position in many ways. So it's sitting on North Terrace, the sort of the grandeur and the stature of North Terrace itself, and it's a gateway building both to North Terrace and coming in from the north and from the Morford Street Bridge. It also sits in a precinct, a very, very new precinct. And as we sort of said, you know, this is a precinct that's really made very much of sort of a whole series of 21st century new buildings. So we've got the Convention Centre, which has just been refurbished. We've got the proposals that the University of Adelaide are making for their new medical building. We've got the extraordinary SAMRI, and we've got the new hospital as well, NRA. So how do we begin to sit into this sort of, you know, heroic world of 21st century architecture? There's an enormous amount going on. There's a lot being said with these buildings themselves. But at the same time, as sort of sitting on the edge of this precinct, we're also connected absolutely into the formality of the sandstone and the limestone buildings of North Terrace itself. So the building on the north fronts the river, and on the south fronts is sort of sitting with the grid of Adelaide resting into it. And then it's absolutely a gateway from Morford Street and a number of other links, as well as coming in and out of the city. So as a building form, it can be something, and it's a building that is going to be, as a sort of a pavilion in the park, which was determined by the Common Development Framework, it's going to be absolutely hammered by the sun from all angles. And we've also designed it to maximise views out from both the north and the south. So, you know, we're not sort of closing down an element of the building. So from a sun shading and a solar shading perspective, we need to consider what we do to conceal and to protect the building from the sun while still maximising the views. So architecturally, that can be a building with lots of things stuck on it, or we can look at how we can actually make it something that's a bit more grounded, relating to the rest of the buildings, the older buildings on North Terrace, and actually use the structure of the building itself as part of the framework for the building envelope. So we've taken the perimeter structure of the building, and we're suggesting to expose it. And then we're proposing to draw it up and create a sort of a crown to the building top, so that it's got an elegance and it actually almost dematerializes that structure. And as David said, we've sort of made a building taller than it really is. Then we've taken that and we've looked at how it can be sunshaded and screened within the structure of the building. So all of those little sunshade elements on the northern side are sort of looked at in a material or a colour that are conducive to the materials for the old buildings themselves. And then they're positioned in sort of a scattered and a gentle way so that they begin to respond to the sort of the flickering water of the river to the north. So on the northern side, we've got the sort of heroic columns of the structure and then these sort of series of sub-elements of the sunshades that, that are scattered across the northern facade with the visibility of those terraces within there. And then as we turn around to the south, we don't need horizontal sunshades because the sun's not coming in at the same angle. And so we have a series of vertical shades as the building's sort of fronting a southwesterly direction. And so it softens in its response. It doesn't have the sort of same flickery breakup as it does on the north. It softens its, in its response to North Terrace. And then as it transitions around to the east, it's actually a combination of those two things. So the vertical sunshading of the south and the horizontal sunshading of the north actually combine to form sort of a brise soleil on the eastern side, which is the most difficult element to shade from the south, from the sun because of the horizontal angle that comes in. So the elements on the north have a really big impact on the overall composition of the building itself and still enable maximum visibility for the occupants of the building as well as views out. And then as we come down to the ground plane, we actually begin to use timber in the large windows that frame the galleries and draw you into the entrance. So the materials between these large white concrete columns start to soften and respond to you know, that public interface which is very close to it. To sort of summarise from an environmental perspective, sustainability has been something that's been very important to the University of South Australia, and the approach has been to use an international standard to design and rate the building from an environmental and sustainability perspective. So that is not just about the contribution or the minimal impact the building has on the environment, but it's also about the design of the environment itself for occupants and visitors of the building. And these are just a series of sort of key points. It has an optimised facade, solar shading, high performance glass. You know, the sunshades have a big impact on being able to manage solar access into the building whilst making sure that occupants can see out and maximise those views. There's a large degree of recycled content in the steel, which is predominantly in steel reinforcement. There's low energy selection in the mechanical plant. There's water efficient landscaping, water use reduction through fittings and fixtures through the building itself. There's 260 square metres up on the rooftop of photovoltaic cells. And then from a commissioning and an ongoing use perspective, there's also ongoing tracking of building performance from both energy and water usage. Now, part of the sustainable approach is obviously this lovely urban park that we have sitting in between the University of South Australia's building and the University of Adelaide.
As Christina and Abby have both mentioned, the urban park design is derived from the underground rail easement. So it's actually been quite an interesting exercise to create a quite significant urban place, North Terrace, particularly wedged between two 14-storey buildings. So we've actually, I've just got a plan here of the urban park. What we've done is to actually, you'll notice a series of vertical grid elements, which there were three reasons for that. One was the first was inspiration from the actual city grid of Adelaide, the regimented city grid of Adelaide. And also, because of the unusual nature of the space, it was kind of a counter effect to bring, to counter that through, to bring through into that, you know, through that area. The other thing, probably the third reason, is the grid elements actually mirror the structural form of the building. Now, you can't really see it on this plan, but our columns actually line up with those as well, and they run through into the buildings. What that also does is it enables the creation of a series of platforms, which I'll talk about. Obviously, North Terrace is, as Abby mentioned, rises up and down and so forth, and if you're familiar with the site, the site actually drops down as well. But in terms of how we've designed it, we've actually, the urban park actually steps up to the northern boundary overlooking the rail yards. So what we've also done, I think the next slide actually. Where are we going? Wrong one?
Yep.
Got it. Both university, well, going back a step, both Adelaide University and UniSA have actually collaborated in a pretty sort of involved way in the design of this urban park. And that's been an interesting exercise in itself, and quite encouraging that it's taken a while to actually to get to that point. But when we've really hit our straps now, and we've come up with a very integrated solution. And it's been interesting exercise in itself to do that. What we've also chosen to do, both groups have chosen to actually use the underside of the urban park as a basement. I don't think we initially set out to do that, but very early on it came to the conclusion that to meet the brief we needed to do that. Now, the actual rail easement that Abby mentioned, and Christina mentioned, is actually about 11 metres below ground level. So we've actually got about 5 metres with structure of basement under there. And you can see there's a dividing wall between both urban park areas. The basement of both Adelaide University and UniSA is predominantly parking, car parking and some building services. But it actually works really well, and obviously that comes off of the northern road that Abby mentioned as well. But back to the ground level of the urban park, it's an integrated design solution, but obviously both universities have come at it from their own way as well. And whilst there's a lot of commonality, it is one park, and no one will really appreciate when it's built that it was designed by two groups of people, or constructed by two groups of people, more the point. And if I can find, I can just point, do I get the pointer out, Abby? Basically, the boundary line, you can't really see it there, but it just bisects at a slightly odd angle between the side as well. So it's very interesting in terms of how we detail that and construct it. And there's been quite a lot of work that particularly Warbridge and Gilbert have done to facilitate drainage and so forth. But anyway, what I was saying is that whilst the park has been designed in by two groups of people, it is one park. Probably the main difference, though, between the two sides, west and east, is the paving. So Adelaide University are using a brick paver, and that will flow through into the foyer of their building. And likewise, in our case, we've chosen to use a granite paver, and likewise, that will also flow through into the foyer, and in all likelihood, through to the actual paving as well on the footpath terrace. The concrete strips are approximately 800 wide concrete. They sometimes are above the floor level or the ground level, but oftentimes they're actually flush. So in doing so, along the front, the forecourt of the entry there, we've actually created an open space, and it's at a pretty minor grade. So what it enables is vehicles to access if they need on occasion. They may do so to service exhibitions in the gallery space, maybe two or three times a year perhaps, or there might be external exhibitions outside, there might be food trucks, there might be all sorts of things out there, but it enables a fairly flexible open space outside the entry. Those grid lines, you can see on the plan some small timber, the timber sort of seating areas, and so throughout we've actually created a series of timber platforms. Now whilst you can sit on the concrete plinths, you can also sit on them, and the urban park will be serviced by Wi-Fi and external power points to those areas. So it's quite a well-serviced area for student use. And the extension of that seating is through to the north, and you'll see that large deck area up there, which overlooks the rail yards. That's actually called the Torrens Pavilion, and that is actually on the Adelaide University side. That's driven by their brief, but what that is a covered area. I think they're talking about barbecues. I think it's basically a big open student area. Obviously, that won't be discriminatory in terms of who uses it, so that'll be used by everyone who uses a park, but it just happens to be part of their brief. And I think that's well serviced by PowerPoints and Wi-Fi and so forth as well. And it'll also afford some great views over the rail yards and onto North Adelaide as well. In terms of planting, it's been an interesting exercise because, as you can appreciate, the UniSA building is 14 storeys and it's north of our park, so it's actually quite dark potentially. Well, it's quite shaded at numerous times, a lot of times of the year, unlike the Adelaide University side, which faces direct north. So we've had to be really careful with our selections in terms of species. And it's probably no accident that a lot of the planting is slightly shifted over to the west as well, so you can see that it does get that light. But in terms of planting, we've actually gone for a fairly broad range of selections. There's quite a lot of biodiversity here, which is always a good thing in a planting pellet. I won't go through all of these in detail, but in summary, there are native, it's predominantly native with some exotics. We have native grasses, buffalo turf, exact to be confirmed, some climbers around the northern pavilion. In terms of the trees, of which there are a few, you go back, you can see the cluster of trees through the centre of the park. They're proposed to be tuckeroo, which is a hardy and appropriate species for public spaces, and are actually found in quite a few university precincts around. They're good from a security point of view in the sense that they have a fairly high canopy, they don't grow too high, about 5 to 6 metres, and they'll work well with our lighting plan, which we're still working through at the moment. Down in the north, where the steps are, and just to the left, you'll see that ramp area off of North Terrace. Not that it's necessarily a full, it's not a ramp per se, but it can be, you can actually access there if you need. Along those steps, we have what we're calling rain gardens. So because the urban park falls to the south gradually, whilst there's a stormwater system to pick up most of that, there's also the capacity for those rain gardens to pick up quite a bit of water as well. And so they've been planted out with sub-aquatic species, and they then take the water, detain it, and then move it onto the stormwater system. Broadly speaking, there are a series of platforms, and I think the fly-through, and I've got some perspectives that may give you more of an idea, but there are definitely areas of accessibility. And as I mentioned earlier, you can clearly walk across the front forecourt, and there are traversing paths through the urban park as well, which are flat. We've worked pretty closely with an accessibility consultant to nail that brief as well. So there's just some examples, a nice shot of the roof as well. You can see, it's a little bit difficult to exactly express it, but you can see that's the front entry through there. Through there as well. And that's a view standing, I think, in the middle of the urban park, looking back towards North Terrace. And it's a very similar view as well. We're nearly we're close now to resolving the design of it in terms of, you can see it is pretty resolved. It's actually a reserved matter in our planning approval, so we've just got to go back to DAC and get that closed out. But that's all in process the next few weeks. I think probably the most exciting thing now is a fly-through.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to?
So in addition to the drawings and a number of views that you've seen, we've also put together an animation giving everyone a better description of the way the building has evolved. As well as that animation, we have a very little model here, which you're more than welcome to come up and have a look at, crowd around it. Architects always like to do things small. But we'll take you through this. It runs for about 3 minutes.
Since its foundation in 1991, the University of South Australia has innovated, influenced and reshaped the city of Adelaide as a city of learning. With its new gateway project for the South Australian Health and Medical Research Precinct, UniSA is once again pushing boundaries, raising the bar and positioning itself at the frontier of new knowledge. On the ground floor, the university will house SciCEd, the Science, Creativity and Education Studio. Positioned at the interface of science, art and innovation, SciCEd will be the nation's newest interactive public science and creativity space. SciCEd will attract and engage all ages, stimulating and captivating visitors' imaginations through reconfigurable public spaces. And contemporary and rotating exhibitions on science and the technological world, and augmented through dedicated makerspace, SciCEd will bring science, technology, engineering and maths to life through interaction and excitement. This new infrastructure and patient-centred environment puts UniSA at the vanguard, translating these innovations into better patient outcomes while grounding the education of our students in real-world practice. Through a groundbreaking alliance with SA Pathology, the University of South Australia is now home to the Centre for Cancer Biology, or CCB. The CCB is one of the world's leading research concentrations in the field of cancer. The new CCB laboratories in the Health Innovation Building will accommodate up to 250 dedicated cancer researchers from around the world, collaboratively innovating in the fight against cancer and translating leading-edge research into novel treatments for the future. The University of South Australia's Health Innovation Building is a gateway development set to transform education and research and transform the city and its future through innovation and enterprise.
Thank you. That was, I think, hopefully we're able to share with you some of the excitement that comes from developing a project like this. It's quite an extraordinary journey and quite an amazing team coming together to deliver it. Very excited to see as we move forward into the next few months to start to see some construction on site, and then the real fun will begin. Thank you again. Thanks so much.